Good morning, everybody. Welcome. It's a big crowd, and we're thrilled that you're all here. Hope you've, if you've been here for tutorials the past couple of days, hope you've enjoyed those. I know you'll enjoy the conference today and tomorrow. I have some, a few announcements. If you're here from outside the United States, would you stand up so we can acknowledge you and welcome you? Great. We appreciate your attendance. At last check, this was the list of delegates. I'm sorry if I've missed your country, if you're late register, but welcome to the conference. I want to remind you of the Equality and Leadership Summit on Friday. Some of you have already signed up for that, but others have not. If you haven't, if you're interested, take a look in the conference brochure. There's an additional fee, but there's still time to sign up. So we'd love to have you there for that. Allison, before you come up. I've always wanted to do that. Let me call your attention to this little blue piece of paper that's sitting on beside you or underneath you that has the schedule. In the video, we talked about meet the speaker lunches and one-on-one with presenter times. Here are all the details. You'll want to look at this. Now, Allison, come and tell us about Women Who Test.
Thanks, Lee. Good morning, everybody. On Friday at this conference, we have an extra day, and there's a testing and leadership summit, which is a fantastic thing for people to go to. So if you're not registered for that and you want to register for that, I would encourage you to do so. We also have a day that's complimentary for women in software testing. And this day was put together at STAREAST last year. It was a huge hit. The women that went absolutely loved it. Women in technical careers are often well outnumbered by their men. As I found every day that I sat at lunch, I was one of two women at the lunch table. And this is a chance for women to get together and talk about the challenges that they have that might be unique and individual from other people in the software industry and their careers. So Jennifer Bonine also talks to you about branding yourself, because part of selling yourself and selling your career, it's kind of like a full-time marketing job for you. And women sometimes aren't really great at doing that and advocating for themselves. So she does a session on that. Jamie Newbury does a great session on burnout, when you're tired and burned out because of the many demands of your life, how she turned her life around and using some design principles that she uses in software design in order to do that. And we network together and workshop. So if you'd like to join us on Friday, you can sign up. It's free and it's a really fun day. It's 8:30 to 4:30, and we would love to see you. And thanks to so many women for being here. Really appreciate it.
Thanks, Allison. She's put together a great program, and encourage you to go join that. Now, I want to tell you a little bit about the test lab. Let's have our test lab leaders come up. This is a great opportunity for you to use your testing powers, and so tell them all about it.
Thank you. Hello. I am Adina, and
I'm Jyoti. Welcome, you all.
And we are the
test lab.
So what is the test lab? The test lab is the place in the conference where you can actually test.
So this year we have chosen Humanitarian Toolbox. As if you have come to the test lab yesterday, then some of you have noticed that we are testing the crisis check-in app. And this app is all about us volunteering in case of a disaster. So if you come into the test lab, not just sit at the computer and chit-chat, but I really want you to learn something new. And while you learn this new stuff, we also encourage you to let the others know. Go back and tell them what did you learn at a conference. And you didn't come and just warm the seats, but actually got to test. And this is what we'd like to do. And we have these little boxes called black boxes designed by Altim. And please do try out some of the puzzles here.
Yeah, so in the test lab, you have the chance to test the application, also practice your problem-solving skills with these boxes and Lego Mindstorms. And also, if you want to socialize with other testers, feel free to come. We have a cozy sofa there, so we welcome you there. Thanks.
Thank you all. Have a great event.
So I encourage you to visit the test lab. You'll enjoy your time there. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our opening keynote speaker, Keith Klain, who's going to talk about lessons learned in selling software testing. Let me read the official biography here. For the last 20 years, Keith has built software quality management and testing teams for global financial services and IT consulting firms in the U.S., the U.K., and the Asia Pacific region. Keith designed the software testing education program with the Bronx-based nonprofit Perscolis, which has graduated over 150 students now from diverse backgrounds into jobs in technology. If you don't know about that particular program, you really should look into it. It's an amazing thing that they're doing. He was executive vice president of the Association for Software Testing, and in 2013, the recipient of the Software Test Professionals Luminary Award. It's my pleasure to introduce Keith Klain.
Thank you, sir. That sounded impressive. Better be good then, eh? How is everybody, all right? Yeah? Excellent. It's nice to be back at STAREAST. Interestingly enough, the last time I spoke at STAREAST was in 2012 doing a keynote on the work I was doing at Barclays. And my talk today is about my transition from taking that model that we introduced there, a kind of enterprise-wide context-driven testing approach to software testing, and moving from the buy side to the sell side. But first, I wanted to give you all an update. I have joined a fantastic company based out of New Jersey called Techmark, so that's where I'm at now. They've been in business for about 30 years. They're a complete solutions and staffing business. I'm joining them to head up their software quality management practice and testing. They're really fantastic and well-known, particularly in Northeast, but they're also a global company. They have an office in London. And I'm very honored to be joining the management team. And it's going to give me an opportunity to take the work that we've done in the past and expand it. They're a very philanthropic organization. They've worked with Perscolis and Power, and I'll be able to continue the work that we've done there in the Bronx and elsewhere across the country. So I'm very excited and happy I can change my title from consultant to whatever that fancy title is I have now. So, but now on to my disclaimers. So I add things to the beginning of my talks because I think it's important for people to give context. And if people are the biggest contributor to context, it's important that you know who I am and what my context is. So my context in software testing is what I call enterprise technology. So this is large organizations, typically financial services or insurance, that build technology, but their core business isn't technology. So that's like Barclays, UBS, Citigroup, working as a consultant in those areas. And the reason why I think that's important to give you that context is that they typically don't always use the best software methods, build methods. They're usually large, diverse groups of people. The enterprise has a very unique set of challenges that can really affect how you approach software testing. And particularly in the software testing industry, the enterprise has been highly commoditized, it's been extensively offshored, and generally has a very low value proposition. So that's what my experience has been. I haven't worked at sexy technology companies like Google or Facebook or anything like that. I've worked at behemoths like Barclays and Citigroup. And what I call it sometimes is where a lot of good ideas go to die. So that's where my struggle has been. And that's where I'm coming from. So the next thing I like to tell people is that I used to include this slide in all my talks to poke fun at a certain individual. People who know me well will know who I'm talking about. But I think as well, having moved from the buy side to the sell side, this should include me as well. So I'll read that to you. If you don't know, everyone know who Daniel Kahneman is? Yeah, if you haven't read Thinking Fast and Slow, you should really read it. It's a great book, and a lot of stuff in there for software testers. But the quote says, right, overconfident professionals sincerely believe they have expertise, act as experts, and look like experts. You'll have to struggle to remind yourself that they may be in the grip of an illusion. I think, you know, particularly for the next couple days, that's probably a good framework to judge the things that you're hearing. There's a lot of confirmation bias and a lot of things that may be true to you, or your survivorship bias is kicking in, but it may not necessarily be true in the classical sense of the word. Which leads me to my next bit, is that everything I'm saying and probably what you've heard from just about everybody else will serve you very well. You know, good testers have skepticism kind of dyed in the wool. I think we shouldn't accept what we see or hear at face value. You know, I usually tell my kids, believe none of what you hear and half of what you see. But I think, you know, you should definitely take what you're hearing and putting it into your context and treating it well, how that is relevant to you. So with that, I also like to delineate between what's your opinion and what's your experience. So I left a great job running the Global Test Center at Barclays to try and expand the use cases for context-driven testing, and I won't get into what that is or the principles behind it. You can do your own research on that. But it's I think probably more true to the sense of the word testing in the kind of scientific method model approach to testing. It's an information-based and context-based approach to testing. And so I wanted to move beyond the transition that we'd made at Barclays, moving a large enterprise towards that model, and see if we could do it in other organizations. So today I'm going to talk about my opinions on some of the lessons that I learned moving from the buy side to the sell side. And I'm also going to talk about, there's four main lessons I learned, and then I'm also going to talk about what I think can be done so that you don't have to continually relearn those lessons from my experience. So the kind of diagnosis is my opinion, and the cure, I think, is my experience. So after I left Barclays and started going out meeting with clients and trying to talk them about context-driven testing, there was a distinct feeling that came over me, and it was kind of hard to describe, but I think this is the best way to describe it. Has anyone ever had that feeling before? Raise your hand if you felt like that before. Yeah? Thank you for raising your hands. Thank you. I'm not the only one. You know, what I found was that working in an enterprise environment had kind of, you know, hardened my skull into a uranium-depleted helmet where a lot of ideas I wasn't hearing. And particularly when you add in I was comping all these people, you know, it's probably in their best interest, as much as a skeptic as I like to take myself to be, when you're paying people, generally they're going to try and agree with the person who's giving you their bonus check. And I know we like to talk about in tech a lot about, you know, eating your own dog food. But, you know, it's really easy to not really see how the dog food actually tastes when you're paying everyone. You know, and confirmation bias is also a really powerful drug if you've got a touch of imposter syndrome as well, where, you know, imposter syndrome is, you know, high-achieving people feel like they don't know what they're doing. And I think particularly in software testing, it's really pervasive because it's a very weird business that we're in. And there's a lot of mixed messages that come from vendors and consultants. And a lot of times you can feel like you don't know what you're doing in this business, and particularly for people who come at it from all sorts of different backgrounds. So that really wasn't a lesson, that was more of a realization. So the first lesson that I really learned is that, you know, despite me seeing this in the enterprise or at Barclays, other companies as well are really horrible at defining their objectives for why they're testing. And I, you know, this is one of those things that I always felt to be true. You guys watch Bill Maher, you know, he says, I can't prove this, but I know it's true. Well, getting out and talking to clients and meeting other large financial institutions and doing reviews of their testing approach, people still are not aligning their test approach to their business. You know, we've done lots of reviews of automation. And the first question I used to ask people when I reviewed test automation frameworks at the various companies I've worked at is, well, what would happen if we stopped running this? And you generally get the RCA dog, you know, I don't know. And so, okay, well, next question is, what does it do? And you still get a lot of, I'm not really sure. You know, and that's there is so much sunken cost bias in a lot of the test automation that's done. And unfortunately, I'm probably getting hate tweeted right now as being a Luddite, you know, or actually hating test automation, but it's not true. I think there's a lot of value to be achieved from it, but we just kept coming across organization after organization that were just running and building these things. I talked to a financial services company in Connecticut, and you know, I sat down with the engineers and said, how do you go about defining which tests you're going to run, which tests you're going to automate? And I appreciated the candor, but the guy said, well, we just see if we can. Not should we, or is there any value to it? People are still making these kind of bad decisions. And particularly a thing that I'm coming across as well recently is large enterprises that are trying to transition to Agile, where they've made a lot of investments in COEs, in centralized testing, and then suddenly they're bolting on a whole mobile or digital division to that that has a completely different paradigm in terms of how software is built and deployed, and they can't reconcile the two. And so you find this, you know, kind of non-congruence between the two sides of the organization. The other side of this as well, and I did this at Eurostar when Michael was chairing. I went around the expo and wrote down about, well, actually I had to stop writing because I ran out of paper, of all the unverifiable claims made by our industry. And yeah, we're not helping ourselves in terms of vendors. I mean, I've got a little pet tweet project right now with this company that keeps tweeting out bug-free software, you know? And it's just, we're not helping that. And I use this term all the time, the amount of algorithmic defect predictinators that get sold to CIOs and CEOs greatly undermines our business. You know, I give this slide in some of the talks I do about how to increase your value as a software tester, and the slide's been in there for, it was based on a report that was done in Europe probably 5-6 years ago about, they polled 1,000 CEOs about how they felt about their technology, and one of the questions was, how do you feel about your testing team? And it was all the classics, too slow, cost too much money, more automation. If we could just fire all these damn people, it'd be so much easier. You know, and honestly, that case really hasn't changed that much. So as an industry, we haven't really done a lot to improve our value proposition. The next lesson that I learned was that what that generally results in is, you like my highly descriptive slides, is how people, you know, in the enterprise treat testing, which is basically what I describe poking the testing robot with the metric stick. And it's actually probably worse than that, as you know, I'll paraphrase James Bach, where he says they actually don't want a robot. What they want is a human-based robot skin for a human to get into to then act like a robot. If I butchered that, James, I'm sorry. But you know, like I said, I think that you rail against the dying of the light, but I just saw a report that came out the other day from a company I used to work at talking about their COE and how they were going to, you could have time warped it back 20 years, how that, you know, why aren't we having less people? Why isn't automation saving us time? Why all these investments? Why aren't our vendors driving down our cost base because we've offshored all this stuff? And it literally was like a white paper for all the things that bad approaches to software testing in this model are the direct result from, you know, and it's just literally looking at why aren't things faster, cheaper, we're measuring the hell out of this, counting all our test cases, why aren't we getting better? And this is this is still very valid today. Which, if you see how these lead into each other, what creates in a lot of enterprise testing organizations is a really simple problem. You know, we create a third culture. You know, and this is particularly bad in COEs or organizations that have highly offshored, forget about outsourcing, but have offshored their testing teams. You know, and so in response to that, what I've seen is that, and this has been around for a while, is that the testing community, you know, creates our own language. And instead of learning the language of our business or our projects, we create a jargon-filled world that we can communicate with each other. And in fact, we don't all really agree what we call things either. And it creates this kind of subculture where people look at us like aliens, and you walk up to people and start talking about defect leakage and other things, and you know, we can't even agree what it is, and then you just, people tune out immediately. And I think there's too much focus on trying to teach people about what software testing is, as opposed to trying to increase our value proposition and articulate what that is. You know, I always said a good barometer for me, and I gave a talk about this last year, is how to talk to a CIO about software testing. And my answer to that is don't. I don't want to talk to my CIO about software testing. That's my domain. That's my responsibility. I want to talk to the CIO about the business, about how I'm adding value, how I'm helping protect the brand and mitigating risk. So I think this is, you know, we tend to insulate ourselves and create this third culture. And so, which in my context, which is particularly the skilled testing or context-driven testing community, this creates a reaction as well that, you know, I believe has tended us to be what I call smarty pants syndrome. And, you know, where we feel like we're undervalued, people don't understand what we do, we've created this language that we don't think people understand, so we tend to kind of be jerks about it. And, you know, one of the things I found to trying to recruit context-driven testing test leads, people who identify with the community and who can manage a project or manage a group of testers, is that they're incredibly hard to find. And I think there's two reasons for that. One, and I'll you know, again paraphrase James Bach as well, is what he calls the tiger cub problem, where you know, you teach people how to test better, use their brains, you unleash the power of creativity and all these other things, and they grow these claws, you know, but they don't know how to kill the bunny, right? So they're walking around, slashing at everything, and they're arguing with people. When you teach people how to argue, you also need to teach them how to pick their battles. And I think what I found through hiring and really kind of letting some test leads go is that there's a lot of work that needs to be done in our community on giving people the right, we do, I guess in the workforce development world, you'd call it train and pray. Where you give people skills and hope they know how to use them. And the other thing about that is I think the community is relatively young. There's a lot of immaturity. So if you've got people who want to be skilled testers, who want to use their brains, it's going to attract a certain type of person that probably is going to be more aggressive. And I think that was a particularly hard problem to churn through a lot of test leads. The other thing about this is that people get allergic to words, which, and I think maybe I've been around too long to care too much about it, but you can give, you know, people, if I said test case, you know, probably half the people in this room's spine just stiffened, you know, or the other half's like, yeah, you know, absolutely test cases, you know, or test scripts is another one, you know, or I've seen, and you know, a good friend of mine sitting up here will can relay the story at some point about this passive aggressive and sometimes just aggressive word correction. And I've seen people have conversations where, you know, the one person who's talking about software testing, and the other person's saying QA. And they'll say, well, did you QA that? And it's like, well, yes, I tested it. Well, when is it gonna come out of QA? Well, when we finish testing it. And, you know, I wanna be specific in language, and I think there's a lot of value in that, but I also don't just wanna piss everybody off. And I think sometimes that's what that does. So I think as a community, and I'm gonna be very careful how I say this, because the last time I gave this talk, I got tweeted very in out of context and got flamed for a week after it. But what I'm gonna say now is that as a community, I think we need to do a better job shepherding people into this community around our values and principles about how we treat people, not just how we use language and conduct software testing, but also how we treat people, the values and principles that come with that, not just focus on the ceremonies. So those were the four main lessons that I learned about objective, smarty pants syndrome, third culture, and this is where I felt like I was. And this slide I've used a lot in an introductory to software testing class that I give to the Perskolis grads. And does everyone know what this is? So that's Edmund Hillary, Sir Edmund Hillary, and Tenzing Norgay, the very first time they summited Everest. And, you know, they didn't have the benefit of, you know, ladders roped up over the ice falls and things like that. They were up there with rope and each other, essentially. And the first time they summited at about 28,000 feet is what's now called the Hillary Step. The first time they encountered it, it was just basically called a 40-foot sheer rock face. And so they get to 28,000 feet, and I can just imagine feeling they had when they got there. So they figure out how to scale this thing, get to the top of that, and they think, great, we're at the summit. Oh my God, no, we're not. There is another 1,000 feet of the worst, slow, flat drudgery up to the actual summit. And so this is a metaphor for how I describe a career in software testing to new testers. And yet we've graduated 150 people into new software testing jobs. The point I'm trying to make is that software testing is, you could make an argument, a relatively new career. There's a lot of learning and discovery being done, you know, around the language and how we do this. And your career is not going to be just enlightenment throughout the entire thing. There's going to be periods of, we get to a plateau, I understand something, I get over that step, and then I think I figured it out, oh, wait a minute, and that's not called that anymore, I find out. And I've used this to help software testers and new software testers guide them through that process, that it's not all figured out, that there is a lot to learn yet in this business. And again, with my kind of, you know, smarty pants hat on, thought it was mainly about other people, and I really learned it was primarily about me. So that's where I am right now with everyone else. So now I want to get into what I view as my experience in some things I've learned over the last couple years that are going to help me specifically, because it's all about me, prevent me from relearning some of those lessons again. And the first one is, and I've talked a lot about this, is to combat poor objectives, if you cannot draw a line directly between your business, and when I say your business, I mean like what your business actually does and how you're supporting it, directly to what you're doing every day, in my experience, I think you're doing it wrong. Right, and this is how I view that hierarchy. The business first, then the technology that supports it, the programs, right, how you test, and then your own personal objectives. One, I think that's just a really good career path to be on. If you can't constantly refocus what you're doing towards how you're helping the business, I think you can go down rabbit holes. You can get, that's why I think a lot of automation projects who start out, you know, on the path to hell with the best intentions, go off course rather quickly, is that we're not refocusing what we're doing on how we're directly helping the business. You know, I used to do this at Barclays all the time, and I've, you know, used it as a metaphor now, but we would call it the critical defect test. So if our CIO walked into the room and asked you, you know, stand up and tell me the last critical defect you found in test and what its business impact would have been if it would have got into production, right? Tell me right now, stand up. So you don't have to stand up. right? But I would do that in our testing groups. And if you couldn't do that, I think you're not focusing what you're doing on the business. You know, how do you get this information? You know, I've given this advice as well, and I need to actually track down the gentleman that gave it to me years ago, was that, you know, particularly in the enterprise, which are typically, you know, publicly traded companies, go pull your company's 10K, right? And look up what their, that will have all their risks, their business objectives, their competitors' information, all that stuff. It's just like a target-rich environment for test ideas. And they're all going to be focused on the actual business. You know, and I think as well, people say testing is a service, but it's not a servant, right? So we should be objectivity as a tester is part of your responsibility. And I think that will help you refocus on providing objective information while not solely focused on trying to get a product or project out. Now that may sound like those is counterintuitive, but I personally don't believe your sole objective as a tester is to help products get out. You're to provide information. And a tool I think that you can use to help with learning the business is what's a fantastic book that you know, Michael Bolton put me onto, which is Rethinking Expertise, which is about interactional expertise, which, and I, again, at the risk of insulting you, I'll just read, it's expertise in the language of a specialism in the absence of expertise in its practice. And if you think of expertise on a continuum, where on one end you've got kind of beer mat, Cliff Clavin from Cheers, you know, knowledge, to the other side where you're really contributing to the science. You are at that white hot core of actually moving the science forward. Interactional expertise is being able to talk to people in, across that spectrum while in their language, not in yours. And I have to give another credit to Martin Hinier, who put me onto a book called Trading Zones and Interactional Expertise, as written by Michael Gorman. We're talking about how to put some of that stuff into practice. So they're two very good books. They're not huge that you should read. But I truly believe you should learn the language of your business and speak that and your projects, as opposed to trying to contribute through forcing our jargon on people. So if you want to, you know, I guess what's the saying? The beatings will continue until morale improves. If you want to, you know, take a few less whacks from the metric stick, I believe that test management is 80% hands-on. And I think one of the banes of our industry is what I refer to as operational test management, which is managers of managers, or as I like to call them at UBS, the coloring in boys. These are just people who produce metrics reports, who are just kind of looking at spreadsheets all the time, you know. And so to give you a frame for this, at Barclays, I had 1,700 testers working for me across the whole of the investment bank and wealth management. I managed that entire group with 5 managers. Everybody below those 5 managers tested 80% of the time. And so what I put into the definition of test management for me is also things like, you know, obviously hands-on testing, but I believe that mentoring is part of hands-on testing, sitting next to people, pair testing, coaching, watch me do it, now you do it. All these things that you can get involved in from a hands-on perspective are included in that paradigm. But if you are spending more than 20% of your time on reporting or progress or any of that stuff, I think that's a big red flag for me to rethink how you're actually managing the software testing. So the third culture, and this is going to be my advice, just a tick list of things that, again, they're heuristics for me for a high-functioning software testing program in the enterprise. And the 30-70 rule for me is I would like to see 30% perm staff, 30% external staff and 70% perm staff, which is generally on its head from what most enterprise groups run. I've been in this business for nearly or over 20 years now. I have been sold, never bought, but sold countless COEs. I don't know what they are, center of excellences. I don't know how they operate. So I think the paradigm in itself creates barriers that don't need to be there. So my advice would be not to do a COE. Constantly refocusing your business perspective and reorganizing to make sure that reliable is the time it takes us to start testing. Because in all its guises, whether that's testing our requirements, testing our use cases, or actually physically testing things. When did we start asking critical questions about this program? You can kind of mark how that, because that will give you an idea of how much test prep and work is required to start getting information back to the program. But that's usually it. I've never seen, I put the responsibility at the feet of the testing business, the testing industry, for why testers are continually asked for all these crazy metrics is because the CIOs and CEOs and program managers are sold it. They're constantly, the echo chamber of the software testing industry is constantly ringing with the siren call to count things. There's your insight, James. All right. So intermediaries, I wouldn't use those. And that, what I mean by that is, particularly if you've got an offshore team or a centralized testing group where, Joe Bloggs, program manager talks to Jane Bloggs, test manager, and then they go talk to their respective teams. I firmly don't believe that because you should manage things, together as a team. And as well, if you do have a central test group, keep all the middle management away from it because they will generally just try and find things to do and create a lot of havoc for what you really want is a tightly integrated test approach with your program. So combating smarty pants syndrome, I like this quote from the good doctor that we're never right, we can only be sure that we're wrong. And I think particularly around language, or if you're trying to help people, and this is one of the things that I've continually tried to coach test leads on, is if you want somebody to do something, the Eisenhower quote, because you want them to do it, you want somebody to do something you want because you want them to do it, why do we instantly start beating them over the head with the language that they use? And this is about test cases and test scripts and QA. And again, I'm not a fan of imprecise language, but I think it's important to think of yourself, particularly if you're trying to improve your lot in life as a tester, think of yourself as a GP, not as a GP, but as an ER surgeon, right? So we're in, the meatball surgery from MASH. I'm probably dating myself with some of these analogies, because again, correcting language just upsets everyone, and you're already dealing with somebody who's sick. Let's not beat them up over the fact that they're sick. Right, they already know that, or maybe they don't. And again, I saw this great quote from Ben Simo the other day on Twitter. He said, there's a big difference between imposter syndrome and just being an imposter. All right. So how do you go about this? And I try and include these in my life as well as how I approach my job, which, again, I think particularly over the last couple years, has really made a difference in how I help people get better at software testing. The first one is, humility. And does everyone know who Neil deGrasse Tyson is? Yeah, a bunch of testers who probably do. You know, he talks a lot about the cosmic perspective and being in awe of the universe and not making you angry or feeling insignificant, but feeling empowered and humble and all that, in the face of all that. And I think there's a lot of good analogies between that and software testing, the, you know, impossibility of complete testing, just the pure maths around some of this stuff. You know, asking, you know, peering into the abyss of infinite possibility and being asked to figure out whether a product is safe to ship or not. You know, that's quite a daunting task. So being humble in that and not acting like you know all the answers already, I think is a great position to start talking to people about testing. You know, being self-aware, how you're contributing to the problem. And, you know, I think this is, you know, the first question I've always asked whenever I've gotten involved in a management dispute or anything with my teams is, you know, what are you doing to contribute to this problem? And being self-aware as an industry of what we're doing, if we feel like testing isn't valued, and this is like pervasive in what's been written about software testing, why is that? You know, are we doing that? And I believe firmly that the answer to those questions lies in how we're acting. I talked about, you know, being a service but not a servant. You know, inclusion, as far as testing is concerned, to me, is about letting people understand how hard it is, you know, what we're trying to do, and that we're trying to, you know, protect the company and risk, but it's actually very difficult. That's why I think pair testing is a great process, but also from how we develop test ideas. And that's why I really like, you know, it's not a practice-based approach, but one of the things that I learned about greatly through the context-driven testing community is using alternative methods for test strategies. You know, at Barclays, we coined the term visual test models, where we did a lot of modeling either on whiteboards and use that, and you can get people in a room and collectively identify risk as opposed to trying to document it in a giant, you know, 20-page test strategy nobody's gonna read. And I think the last part there is about being context aware, and this is, again, a kind of mild criticism, I think, of the context-driven testing community, is that for all our talk about that, I see a lot of people who don't include the context they're in terms of the people and company, as opposed to just focusing on practices. And I think that is probably one of the biggest contributors to helping people get better at software testing, or at least, you know, from the most lowest level, making your life easier. You know, understanding who the people are you work with and how, you know, they're contributing to the culture around testing and what you can do to improve that. So, and lastly, and this is going to be a bit of, you know, eating my own dog food here, you know, manage your own expectations. You know, I recently wrote an article for a fantastic testing magazine called Testing Trapeze, and I called it the, you know, Dr. Strange Career, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Software Testing Industry. And it was after going to the QA Symphony User Conference and listening to Scott Birkin, who is a fantastic author and speaker, and lots of stuff that he talks about. The innovation that you should read and listen to him talk is fantastic. But he gave the keynote there, and it was a little bit of an epiphany for me that, you know, and it's going to sound funny, but, you know, why am I always feeling like, God, I just want to get out of this business? You know, we don't make it any improve. It's so hard. And he talked about, you know, Magellan. And, you know, what's Magellan known for? Circumnavigating the globe, right? Well, he actually didn't. You know, he died before he did. And, you know, he says, like, well, why, you know, but he's generally given credit for it. And the thought occurred to me, like, well, you know, of course, because he was trying to circumnavigate the globe, like the, you know, 16th century dummy, you know, it was hard what he was doing. And a lot of what we do in software testing is very hard. And, you know, I think personally that's what makes it great. So with that, thank you for listening to me. And that's me done.